Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Nice to be back with you again. In fact, it's nice to be here all together. I should stop saying that since I've joined St. Paul's and I have started coming regularly now, so for better or for worse. Grace, mercy, peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. We're looking at scripture today. We're obviously going to hear it read, but we're going to see how important scripture is in our lives. And probably it's one of the reasons why Christianity is so weak in the West, in South America and America, in Africa, across Asia. The strength of Christianity grows because they are people of the Word. Here, we've had 300 years of attack on Scripture, and we are suffering for it, suffering from it. So that's our theme for today. Let's just come before the Lord, thinking of how maybe we've left His Word, His love letter, out of our lives. Think of the times that we've been in control of our lives and we've not let the Lord have a word in edgeways, sideways, anyways at all, together. Lord, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy upon us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord. May Almighty God, who has sent his Son into the world to save us sinners, bring us pardon and peace, now and forever.
Amen.
Let's stand and praise the Lord with this, these next words. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father.
Amen.
O Lord, we beseech you mercifully to hear the prayers of your people who call upon you, and grant that they may both perceive and know what things they ought to do, and also may have grace and power faithfully to fulfill them. Through Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, we ask, the one who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, and yet one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. Please be seated. And listen for a while pity to stop that, really, isn't it? Much rather listening to that voice than mine. So we come to our readings this morning, and just as a way of introduction, you've got the sermon before and in the middle and a little bit afterwards, but it's still the same length and you'll still get home for your lunch, so don't worry too much. This truly is God's love letter to us. This is the God who didn't just put us on this dark planet as it was then, but he gave us light. He gave us his directions in love. He could have just left it, couldn't he? He could have just said, there we are, get on with it. But he didn't. Put them in the Garden of Eden, and then he came and he visited them, and even when they decided they'd be their own gods, still he said, I'll still watch over you, I'll still come to you, I'll still guide you, I will still send you my directions, I'll send you the workbook on how to work this planet. That's basically what we've got in Scripture. It's a handbook. How to run our lives, how to make this planet go round the right way, in the way that it should. And people have given their lives for this book. And sometimes we just listen to the epistle, and sometimes we don't. And sometimes our minds get caught up in maybe what's going on for dinner, what we're doing this afternoon, what is coming up this week, are the problems and the troubles that we've got in life, sometimes the joys. And sometimes we come to the end of the reading and we parrot off the response and maybe God forgive me when I do that. And maybe, hopefully, you say that you feel the same. But we can take it just simply as a matter of rote, take it for granted. And Jesus, I'm just skipping ahead here, I'm just going to read out one of the paragraphs. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even on a cross. You see, Jesus took this book seriously. He didn't have the whole book, he didn't have the New Testament. He was still busy writing that in the minds of the experiences of his followers, but he had the Old Testament, he had 300 prophecies to dealing with what the Messiah was going to be and who he was going to be. He looked at the whole panoply of what had happened over the thousands of years before he came, and on that basis, on the basis of this word, he was prepared to go to the cross of Calvary. Even though when he'd been walking through on those 3 years of ministry, he'd have come over a hill and probably seen a line of crosses, probably heard the agonizing cries. He knew full well what a crucifixion was, and he knew full well that he was going to suffer the worst type of crucifixion, not just tied on a cross, eventually after 3 days having your legs broken so that you can't breathe. That's usually how crucifixion went. But the most horrendous way of doing it, and all the torture that went on before, he knew this was coming. And still, he went to the cross because he believed this word. And so did so many others. I've been reading over this last 3 months a trilogy, which has taken me from 1066 and the Conqueror, William the Conqueror coming in, getting the kings mixed up, and then right on to the Tudors, and Henry VIII and going on to Queen Elizabeth. And so many times people being burnt at the stake because they were selling English Bibles. Because only the church and the learned people could learn Latin and read the scriptures for themselves. because only those who are wise enough, only those with the priests, the bridge before God and humanity, only those could give the right word. And then came the Protestant movement, and when the church got so bad and corrupt, and people went in agony because they wanted the word of God to come into our lives and into our hearts. That's how important it is. Can we have our first reader, please, who's going to do the epistle? Thank you.
First reading is taken from Philippians chapter 2. If you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any fellowship with his spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in the spirit and purpose. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourself. Each of you should look not only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others. Your attitude should be the same as that of Jesus Christ, who, being the very nature of God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. This is the word of the Lord.
Verse 9 there, therefore God exalted him to the highest place. So Jesus read the scriptures and then he acted upon them and went to the cross of Calvary, and of course the resurrection came, and therefore the ascension. Therefore God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee will bow. And there are other scriptures that imply that this is going to happen with us as well. Therefore, those who look at the Word of God, those who treat it seriously, those who follow it day in and day out in their lives, will also be exalted. We're destined for the throne. I'm reading a book at the moment. That's the title, Destined for the Throne, that God is preparing us right here and now for the new world, for the new heaven and the new earth. No doubt we'll get a rest in between, but we will get to heaven and the Lord will welcome us, make us home at home, and then he will say, and now, having exalted you, let me put you to work on a new endeavor, a new heaven and a new earth. We sometimes think, oh, this is it. It's not. This goes on. This is eternity. This is the kingdom of God that we're dealing with. And this is the love letter and the law statutes of the kingdom of God, as it were. And there were people who tackled his authority. They challenged him. Just as people challenge the Bible today, it's full of contradictions. That's one of the things I get. I've been studying it for 40 years and I've yet to find one contradiction. They're apparent contradictions, but when you know the story behind it, you understand why it is there. This book is completely right on all the things that it speaks about, whether it's sacred issues or secular, whether it's science, whether it's vegetables, whether it's growing, whatever. It is one of the books that just hangs on. It's there and it is always right. Every other book I've ever written has gone out of fashion within 5 or 6 years. Oh, there's something wrong with it, because time's moved on. In fact, that's true of every book that's ever been written, but not scripture. And that was written over 1,500 years, over three continents, by 40 writers. 40 writers putting it all together, and yet it all holds together in one, because there's only one author, the Holy Spirit, who spoke through the minds and the experiences, the loves and the joys of those 40 odd writers. It has an authority of its own. Here we see Jesus and his authority being tackled. Let's have the reading for the Gospel, please. Or am I doing that? Oh, thank you.
Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, taken from Matthew chapter 21. Jesus entered the temple courts, and while he was teaching, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him. "By what authority are you doing these things?" they asked. "And who gave you this authority?" Jesus replied, "I will also ask you one question. If you answer me, I will tell you by what authority I am doing these things. John's baptism, where did it come from? Was it from heaven or from men?" They discussed it amongst themselves and said, "If we say from heaven, he will ask, then why didn't you believe him? But if we say from men, we are afraid of the people, for they all hold that John was a prophet." So they answered Jesus, "We don't know." Then he said, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. What do you think? There was a man who had two sons. He went to the first and said, 'Son, go and work today in the vineyard.' 'I will not,' he answered. But later he changed his mind and he went. Then the father went to the other son and said the same thing. He answered, 'I will, sir.' But he did not go. Which of the two did what the father wanted?" "The first," they answered. Jesus said to them, "I tell you the truth, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God ahead of you, for John came to you to show you the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes did, and even after you saw this, you did not repent and believe him." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Why didn't he answer them? It just seems a reasonable question. What authority have you got? Surely this was a great way, you know, to tell them who he was. Except that by the time this was happening, he'd been showing them who he was for 2.5 years. He was coming up to that point of going to Jerusalem, and ultimately his authority would be questioned when they nailed him to a cross. That's what they thought of him. That's what they thought of him when they asked this question. They were simply trying to trip him up There are people with such a fixed mind, because they're God, that they will only think their way and think that their way is right. And such were the scribes and the Pharisees. There was no way, unfortunately, that God could get through. That's one thing we've got to be careful of, that we should never get blasé, we should never get hardened. We should never be in a mind that God can't reach us. Our whole raison d'etre, our whole reason for living, is that we are open to God, that He's the one who, to guide us, to direct us. He is the one who drives our car, as it were. He's our navigator. He's our sat-nav. Whichever way you want to take it, He's the one who should be guiding us each day and every day. There was a point I made earlier, that Christianity has grown so weak in its Christianity, that the West has grown so weak. The Christian church is almost dying in some parts of the West. And that's maybe true in England. The number of people going to church now has shrunk maybe to its lowest for a good number of years. And it just reminds me, as I begin to wind up this rather elongated round the way sermon, of a film, quite a horrible film in some ways, but strangely attractive of the nature, real nature of mankind. It's called King Rat. It comes on television every now and then. I'm reminded of it this Sunday because of the Singapore grip that's begun to be shown on television. It's a time when the war had been going on for a bit. The Japanese were joining in, and they were attacking from the east, and Britain was surrounded. It couldn't do anything. It was fighting Rommel in North Africa. It was fighting the U-boats and Bismarck in the Atlantic. It was bringing men back from Dunkirk, from Europe. It was fighting for its life, and Singapore cried out for help, and we couldn't send any. And of course, in came the Japanese and swept before them. And Changi Jail was the main jail of Singapore, and of course it was filled with prisoners of war. And King Rat was a bit of a wide boy, East Ender. He'd seen it all before. He knew his way around bribery, corruption, and he managed to get himself into such a position that basically he began to boss the whole prison, because he bought and blackmailed people who were running it. He was the one you went to for food. But food was always in short supply. But King Rat strolled round, and his henchmen, well fed, good muscles, good body build. Everybody else in Changi limped around, increasingly like skeletons. They couldn't get fed. They didn't get fed from one day to the next very often. They got a thin gruel when it did arrive. And it's a picture, I think, of Western Christianity. If you think of Western Christianity surviving on the bread of life, we've not done a very good job over the centuries. We, for the last 300 years in the West, have begun to take the Bible to pieces through critical analysis and critical look at Scripture. Has been good, it's shown us new things, but the other way, it's just been dismissed as the writings of men. Oh, the writings of uneducated men as well, because how could they know? Because they lived so far and so long ago. And they hadn't been to Oxford or Cambridge, and they didn't have degrees. Of course, this was a good book, and had some useful tips, but that was it. That's what Scripture became in Christianity. I went to college in the 70s, and my biggest problem was holding out against a bishop who was the leader of the Doctrine Commission. He decided what the doctrine of the Church of England was. And he didn't believe in God. I don't know how he got there. There was his friend Don Cupid, who led the Sea of Faith. The Sea of Faith was filled with all the clever people of all the universities and the theological colleges. He believed God actually was something that existed in there, but nowhere else. In other words, God was a figment of our imagination, and evolution meant that to evolve to a better stage, we developed the idea of God, just to make us more civilized. That counted for nothing. In our hearts and minds today, we can sometimes get like that. We treat the Bible with such contempt. And when we do that, we're like the prisoners of Changi jail, not like King Rat, who sated and filled himself with all that was available, but like the others who never got near food, or when they did get their food, it was a thin gruel. We've got the bread of life, and we can feed on this any time, at any place, every day. We are supposed to be muscular Christians, well-built Christians, Christians who go out to do the Lord's work. We sing that we're soldiers of Christ. But then we actually live as though we are the weaklings of Christ, or afraid of Christ, afraid to mention him in our families or in our neighbourhoods or at work, afraid to witness. The Christian Church sometimes has lost its witness in the world, and it's no wonder, therefore, that maybe we aren't taken into consideration as we should. Paul had a problem, and with this I finish. Writing to the Corinthians, he'd been to Corinthia. And he'd preached, and a church had grown up. Greece was rather like Western philosophy. In fact, the West is built on the philosophy of Corinth. And it is about man, and how man achieves on his own, in his own strength. And it just pointed out that the skeletons of the church were people who never actually bothered to read Scripture. Amazingly, when they did some research recently, they found that People only read scripture when they go to church and it's read to them. Can you imagine what we'd be like if we had one meal a week for our bodies? We'd be like the skeletons of Changi Jail, ourselves inside, skeletal in our spiritual lives, without strength. The Lord's given this book to us so that we may be strong, so that we may have the muscles of Christ, so that we may have the power and the strength to be able to stand in this world which doesn't know where it's going and doesn't know where it's come from and has no idea what it's about. And we can stand there and we can say, this is where we come from and this is why we're here, and actually this is where we're going, and that's either down or it's up. But if you realise that Jesus has come to be your saviour, then you've got a wonderful future. We're destined for the throne, and we need to be fit for that. I'm sorry if it sounded as though I've been telling you off. I've actually been telling myself off. The times I don't read scripture, and the times I come to it and say, for goodness sake, Logan, pull yourself together and start doing what you're supposed to do. So together, let's make a determined effort to take this book seriously and to build our souls and ourselves up and our bodies. Let's stand for the creed. We believe in one God, the Father the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit, the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. And now, let us pray.
Praise and thank you for giving us so much to enjoy in your world. Open our eyes to see all the beauty around us, to appreciate your greatness in giving us the different seasons, each fulfilling our needs. And if we do not understand why nature is sometimes cruel and harsh, and why people suffer from tornadoes and earthquakes, and this year the terrible scourge of COVID-19, Help us to trust where we cannot understand, knowing that you love us all. Help us to do what we can to relieve the sufferings and hardships caused by dreadful events and those caused by human errors. Make us willing and eager to share the many good things you have provided for the benefit of us all. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we pray today for statesmen, leaders, and rulers in our own country and throughout the world. May they be quiet in spirit, clear in their judgment, and able to understand the issues that face them. May they always consider first the needs and concerns of ordinary people on whose behalf they must speak and act. Grant to all leaders patience, courage, foresight, integrity, and most of all, great faith. In their anxieties, be their security. In their opportunities, be their inspiration. And by their plans and their actions, may your kingdom come and your will be done. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for your church in every part of the world, the great family of which we are a part. We pray for those who are denied freedom in their religious beliefs, and especially for those persecuted, tortured, or imprisoned for their faith. May their courage set faith alight in other lives. We pray also for those who struggle against injustice, the men and women who have to establish the supremacy of your love in violent and oppressive societies. May they be filled with your wisdom in their war against inhumanity. We also pray for our fellow Christians in the developing world, those for whom hunger is a daily reality, those who feel powerless to change the ways of nature or the ways of nations. Bring nearer the day of their deliverance. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, you have called us to be a caring church, reflecting in our lives your infinite love for us, your children. Help us to fulfill our calling and to care for one another in an unselfish fellowship of love, and to care for the world around us in sharing with it the good news of your love, and serving those who suffer from poverty, hunger, homelessness, addiction, disease, or any other adversity. We pray for all who are overcome with a sense of despair and rejection. May they put their trust in you to find the help they need. We pray this morning for members of our own congregation, and especially for those who are not with us because of self-isolation, illness, or infirmity. May your comfort and consolation sustain all who are grieving at this time. May all for whom we pray feel your love and support and gain strength from you. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Now let us stand, please. We thank you, Lord, that you've given us your word that brings us peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
We say to each other, the peace the Lord be with us, be with you. The Lord is here.
His Spirit is with us.
give thanks to the Lord our God. Father, you made the world and love your creation. You gave your Son Jesus Christ to be our Saviour. His dying and rising has set us free from sin and death. And so we gladly thank you with saints and angels, praising you and saying,
Holy, holy, holy Lord,
Lord God
Almighty, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest.
We praise and bless you, loving Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And as we obey his command, send your Holy Spirit, that broken bread and wine outpoured may be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends, and taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread and gave it to them and said, Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine, and again he praised you, and he gave it to them and said, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross, bringing before you the bread of life and the cup of salvation. We proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Praise to you, Lord Jesus.
Dying, you destroy our death. Rising, you restore our life. Lord Jesus, come in glory.
Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day when your kingdom comes, and justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favour on your people. Gather us in your loving arms and bring us with all the saints to feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ, with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, O loving Father, forever and ever.
Amen.
And on the right hand page, right-hand side of the page, as our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name.
Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive your purpose to sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Every time we eat this bread and we drink this cup,
we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world,
have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world,
have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world,
grant us peace.
And now draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. Keep you in eternal life. Take and eat this in the name of Christ. The body of Christ given to you. Lord, we just ask that you would bless this young man, give him your peace and strength for his life. Amen. The body of Christ keep you in eternal life. Take and eat in the numbers that Christ died for you here. Take and eat in the numbers that Jesus Christ died for you. The body of Christ given for you. Take and eat in remembrance that Christ died for you in the night. Body of Christ, keep you in eternal life. The body of Christ, keep you in eternal life. Take and eat in remembrance that Christ died for you in the night. Take and eat this in remembrance that Christ died for you. Be blessed. And the body of Christ keep you in eternal life. Take and eat in remembrance that Christ died for you and be blessed. The body of Christ keep you in eternal life. The body of Christ keep you in eternal life. Take and eat in remembrance of Christ died for you. The body of Christ keep you in eternal life. Take and eat in remembrance of Christ died for you. The body of Christ keep you in eternal life. Take and eat in remembrance of Christ died for you. The body of Christ given for you. Take and eat in remembrance that Christ died for you. Can we just take it back half of that? And do that, shouldn't we? Take and eat in remembrance that Christ died for you. Almighty God, you have taught us through your Son, that love is the fulfilling of the law. Grant that we may love you with our whole heart and our neighbours as ourselves, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out to the power of your Spirit, to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Thank you, Kath.
I haven't already received one of these little books from Anne. If have a word with her after the service, if you will, please. Just a reminder about next Sunday, when she's going to be our Harvest Festival. And as we've explained before, we thought it would be nice to have flowers or plants that we could take to people who haven't been able to join us for the service. Or obviously, we prefer the gifts can go to the Bishop's Harvest Appeal. They can be made for church, or of course, we've got the food bag box in the back. So, you know, please feel whatever you would like to do. But if you could just encourage as many people to come to this all-age worship, and hopefully there will be some children with us as well, which will be especially nice. And then a week on Monday will be, as I explained before, our vestry meeting and APCM, so there are details there. And then just finally, I'd like to say to Joan, a special thank you for having prepared this prayer for us, and to show and know that God does indeed answer our prayers. We have been sent for the time, somebody who is a shepherd, a true shepherd, a servant of God, a minister of Christ. And we thank God for sending to us Kevin to lead us for the next few months.
And now go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Are we having, may God's blessing surround us? Wonderful. Well, in that case, we'll give it a miss this time, but just wish each other, as you have done already, the peace of God, the blessing of our Lord. And thank you for being here this morning.